Normal Talk Radio, hosted by Dave Miller.
It is hosted by me. It's what I kind of, it's what I do. Happy Sunday, an early Sunday surprise show that I wasn't going to do, but I decided to do because of all the drama. Oh boy, let's get to it. Okay, so I'm not going to say the name of the person that I purchased the boxes from because he's a friend of mine and I'm going to protect his privacy. But I'm not going to protect the people and their names that attacked me, attacked him, actually attacked him and then, you know, came at me. I don't care about that stuff. It really doesn't affect me, okay? I understand that there's a difference between the traditional Hebrew Dybbuk boxes and all that stuff that's going on out there. Those of you that follow me on Facebook saw my post calling out Maggie White and her fucking, let me get this douchebag's name right. I just want to say his name because I have to. What the fuck is it? It's like Lloyd something or Lloyd, there you are, you fucking hockey goon. It is Lloyd Leland Kelly and Maggie White. Okay, so Maggie White fucking, I don't know what she actually told this guy, but I'm going to play you a voicemail that was left for me by Lloyd Leland douchebag Kelly in his hockey fucking goon face. God, is he a goon? Look him up on Facebook. I'm telling you right now, the guy's a fucking goon. He contacts the person that I went after these boxes. These weren't, they weren't pushed in my face or weren't anything that were offered for me to buy. I happened to see these boxes in this person's collection. And I said, fuck it. I want those. I want those in my studio. I want them. And I usually do. I have this thing about getting the things that I want, and I got them. Okay. Well, I posted some photos up on Facebook and, holy shit, this is where it gets weird. So, Facebook Messenger starts going off, and it's Maggie White. She's telling me all this shit about these boxes are fake, they're not real, you're half Jew, how could you be fucking so careless to disrespect our people, to have all this shit, and, you know, and I'm like, dude, look, you're getting carried away with this stuff. It's stuff that I want to own for my private collection. If you don't like it, I can, you know. So she goes after this guy and, you know, tells me a whole bunch of shit. So the guy that I got the boxes from sent her a message on Facebook and told her, you know, hey, I don't appreciate you saying these things to me, blah, blah, blah. It wasn't anything nasty. I read the messages, so I know. Screenshot, you know? So, then she, like, hits me up with this message saying that this dude is fucking crossed the line and she's gonna go after him, hell, fury, and fire, and, you know, not as cool as Donald Trump said it, but this bitch just went nuts, right? And I said, bitch, yeah, I did. She's a bitch. So, so anyways, man, this fucking guy sends my friend this message and it's totally threatening him. And he's a family guy. He's got kids, small children in his home. He's a good dude. And now he's getting death threats for me going after these boxes. This is where it led, right? So I got pissed and, you know, I started calling people out on Facebook. And this fucking goon, he calls my phone and he leaves this voicemail and listen, I have my ringer off on my phone because of all the notifications and everything that go through Facebook, whether I get messages from Twitter, Facebook, or on the show site. I get a lot of messages, so I fucking turn it off so it doesn't go off all night long, right? Happy life, happy wife, happy life kind of a thing, because when my phone goes off, fucking 24/7, yeah, shit happens. So this fucking doofus calls me up, Lloyd Kelly, you fucking doofus, calls me up and leaves this message on my phone. And he's so fucking stupid that he's not even calling it a Dybbuk box. Listen to this fucking hillbilly. Listen to this guy. He calls it a Demi box.
That ain't even a real Demi box. That ain't even a real Demi box, boy. Maggie.
Yeah, okay. So I've given you enough of that. I'm going to fucking hit my voicemail here on my phone so you can hear exactly. Hang on, cancel. Okay, there we go. Now we're going to dial out. I don't know exactly how this is going to work. It's the first time I've ever played a voicemail.
Listen, press 1, send.
Here you go.
First saved message.
You want to talk to me? Answer your phone next time I call you? No, we can discuss this problem that you got currently with Maggie and me, Lloyd Kelly. Because her, understand something. All she does is try to help you or take you and your family at your request. And then
lie.
Turn around and all that she did then was tell the truth about that is not a Demi box.
A Demi box.
Okay. She didn't do nothing wrong there. You go start a bunch of shit there. I was making sure the other guy let him know the same thing. She didn't start no shit. She just was telling the truth about it being no Demi box. And you go start this shit here. You don't want none. Trust me.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening you.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening nobody.
Oh,
I'm telling you, you don't want none.
Oh.
Okay? And you think I'm going to apologize? For her telling the truth, you think I'm going to apologize by letting y'all know that she told the truth about something? You want to go on the radio and out people? Go right ahead. Because I will come on the radio and I will take and have your Demi box you pull out as experts verify that it's not a Demi box. And then you can yell at them, holler, oh, they're causing trouble. All she did was tell the truth, dude. And keep on. I'll have your fucking show taken off the fucking air.
Oh.
Don't think I won't.
Oh.
I got that kind of power. Don't fuck with me.
Wow.
Okay? I'm trying to do this peaceful. And you come at me sideways like that instead of just talking to me like a real fucking man?
Real fucking
think you're bad or something? You ain't bad. Neither am I.
Ow.
The bad ones is the ones you can't see.
Ooh.
But you know what? The ones you can't see, don't fuck with me.
Whatever.
End of message.
End of message. You know... I actually have to pause at the stupidity that you all just heard. You all just heard. It's a Demi box. It ain't a Demi box. Motherfucker sounds like Les Claypool from Primus. Demi was a race car driver. You know what I mean? Come on, man. Okay. So I got that message and he's going to get my show taken off the air. Lloyd, douchebag, hillbilly. You ain't doing shit, okay? That's why I'm using your name right here, right now. Those are your words. You said this shit. When it comes to Maggie White, we actually were friends at a point, and she did come on the show a couple few times. You know what I mean? But here's the thing. This chick fucking hit me up before all this stuff jumped off with my friend. And she actually told me this. And I'm going to tell you this. This is how disturbing this Facebook Messenger call was that I got from her. She started trying to call up Rod Farrell. And he's one of the makers of one of the Dybbuk boxes that I'm... The Demi box. And he's in prison. He's a very well-known killer who was apprehended for his crimes. And, you know, yeah, the horrible story. But Maggie insisted that I grabbed my pendulum and she's going to call him forward and say, hey, you know, she's like, Rob, you devil, you need to tell me if these boxes are dangerous and all this shit, right? And I'm just kind of fucking standing there stupefied because he's not dead. He's not dead. He is alive. He does his thing in prison. His name is probably not Rob. It's more like Bob and Neil, because that's what he's doing in prison, because he ain't a big dude. This guy is not a big dude. He's at the leniency of the inmates around him. So she's calling him out, and she's saying, I need this devil fucking, you know, blah, blah, blah. So then she tells me, she goes, because of these boxes are in your house, you have now brought a demon into your home, and I have seen a vision of your child, my small son, being raped. Quote, unquote. The demon wants to rape your child. This is a fucking messenger call at, I don't know, 9, 10 o'clock my time. And I'm just beside myself going, what in the fuck? First you want to tell me that these boxes are completely fake, and now you're telling me that there's a demon coming to your home telling you that these boxes want to rape my child. That long pause right there is because she's fucking retarded. Okay. So I get the boxes here and I start doing my test. Now I'm all about paranologies and the paranormal field. I use the Afterlight box and I use the Poltercom from Paranologies. Fucking fantastic ghost boxes. Both of them are great. I love them both. But there is something going on with this Poltercom. As I set the Dybbuk in front of the Poltercom, and this is all audio here. I didn't have any video, and this is an audio show anyway, so you're going to catch a little bit of it. But this, in this 26 seconds of an audio recording I have of a session with the Poltercom, you actually can hear it tell me what the box is called. I have the box in front of the ghost box, and I ask it to tell me what this box is called. So I'll play the whole thing, and then we'll go back and we'll listen to it again.
I'm going to set this box in front here. Can you tell me what this box is? Can you tell me what this is? Here. I got it that time.
Okay, so right there, you hear me say at the end of it. But now, I'm going to play it back for you, and I'm going to stop it every time I hear Dybbuk.
I'm going to set this box in front here. Can you tell me what this box is?
Right there, there's a Dybbuk. Right there, in a really weird woman's voice, it goes, Dybbuk. I'll back it up a little bit so you can hear it. Like I say, I've never done this on the air, so I'm fucking good with it. But here at about 13 seconds, you just hear this really weird voice say it. Here she comes. Dybbuk, right there. And again, here we go for more.
Can you tell me what this is? Here.
There, it tells me it here, and then it's going to say Dybbuk.
Dybbuk. I got it that time.
So, now this is Ghost Box, okay? This is FM Radio Sweep. Now, I don't even know what to say as far as if in 30 seconds, under 30 seconds, I can pull 4 Dybbuks out of the air. It's not me. I don't program that. It's fucking sweeping the radio. And the radio tells me what the box is called. Is that legit? If it was just one time, I could say, well, it could be, you know, whatever. But it's 4. in just that fucking period of time. Now, here's another part of the first session that I did. And as soon as I start hit the record button on this 240, you hear it right away. It even says my name. Right there. I turned the motherfucker on and it says my name. One more time. You know what I mean? Okay. So obviously there's a line of communication there. The ITC sessions that I'm doing are telling me that the boxes are called Dybbuk boxes. They're not Dimmy boxes, you fucking stupid hillbilly. They're Dybbuk boxes. And they are Dybbuk boxes because the spirits are telling me what they're called. One more. I'll play one more audio file before I get my guest on the line here. We're going to just have a nice pair of rap here in just a few minutes. I got my good buddy Landon Wells coming on. You coming on, Landon? You better be coming on, motherfucker. Okay, but here is... Now, this one is about, I think, a minute and... about a minute or 2 minutes long. But as I get about a minute into this, this thing really starts firing up on me. And you'll hear it.
Okay, I'm gonna move this off. Is that better? Can you talk to me and tell me if you like that or not?
My name?
Yeah, that's my name. Do you like this box, or do you want it to go?
Now we're coming up on the spot where it gets real interesting. Okay, that was just a bunch of gibber right there, but... We're coming up on the spot where the box says my name again, and then it tells me to listen close. And that's pretty awesome. Here you go. It's coming up in just a second.
Word. 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 What word? What word should I use?
There's Dybbuk.
Can you tell me what this box is called again?
That's how amazing that is. It says the box. What the fuck? Yes, it says the box, man. After I ask it what to call it. Listen. Right there. Clear as fuck. It says Dybbuk. If you can't hear that, you may need a motherfucking Q-tip. Goddamn. So the moral of the story is one, don't call my fucking phone and leave voicemails for me like that, because I will fucking put you on blast. I don't care if your uncle works for the FCC, the FAA, fucking, Discovery Card. I don't care, okay? I don't give a fuck. You call my phone, that's fair game. I own that property, and I will put your ass on blast. I already know that this has gone on way too long. I'm talking 20 minutes on this shit. But we're going to go to some fun shit right after these commercials, because I'm going to get my buddy Landon on the line and we're going to talk some real fun paranormal shit. You know, I've wasted a lot of money in this business. I really have. I've got a whole case of things that I don't ever use. I mean, they're paperweights. I got them. They got cool looking lights, but they never do anything for me on location. And that's exactly where I come in right here with my favorite company, Paranologies. At Paranologies.com, you can get anything that you're looking for, man. They've got sensors, cameras, audio, lighting, accessories, and even DVRs, man. Their sensors are second to none, period. The 360 periscope, the regular periscope, the electroscope, the pyramid, the geopod, the temperscope, the periscope plasma, the tribometer, the thermoscope. Holy shit, there's a lot of scopes going on out here. Plus the holy grail of them all, the Poltercom and the Poltercom progeny. Don't waste another dime on unnecessary gear. Get a hold of Jeremy Jones at Paranologies.com and get what you deserve in your arsenal. Get results. Paranologies.com. Hey guys, what's going on? This is Dave with 51 Areas Paranormal Talk Radio. If you happen to be in the market for your very own SLS camera, I have found the hidden treasure in the field. Landon and Jerry of the Paranormal Response Team are doing something incredible for all investigators, single or with your team. To your door, you can get your very own SLS camera shipped to your house for $299. And it's incredible because not only do they send you the camera, they send you a couple of videos, show you how to use it, and if you have any questions, you just contact them and their customer service is through the roof. They will help you out. I'm talking through experience here dealing with these guys. They are 100% class and they're doing something great because the technology that you're paying for is just outrageous on some of these sites. But to your door, $299 shipped, and you're on your way. Then you can be just like Zach. Just like Zach. Tell him I sent you, man. Paranormal Response Team on Facebook.
Oh, man. Speaking of the Paranormal Response Team, I happen to have Landon on the line. What's up, man? What's going on?
Hey, Dave. What's going on, man?
Not a dude. Hey, I got to play our theme song. Here we go. It's our theme shit right here. Yeah. Boats and hoes, baby.
There you go. I can't even hear it, but I like it.
I know. I got that option off. All my guests are at my mercy. Okay, so anyway, we're doing some boats and hoes. But in all honesty, man, I mean, you know, I know you're busy. You just had a kind of an epic hunt the other night, man. I mean, you fucking got permission from a politician to do a ghost hunt, and that's pretty fucking insane.
Yeah, man, that's it's kind of wild that even happened. But yeah, we had the mayor of this city here in Georgia give us total permission for this huge Confederate cemetery that we actually did last night. It was really cool, man.
Did you get a
it
lot
was neat? You know, it's
did you get a lot of well, it was a lot of responses, or did you get like did you catch anybody out there trying to fucking deface some graves?
No, nobody was messing with us or messing with the graves or whatnot, but we did get a lot of responses through the box. You know, this was the first time that I took my first box that I've built actually to a haunted site to actually use it. So we got some really good responses out of it there, nice. Especially through your new app that hasn't been released yet. I mean, it was just nuts, some of the things it was saying.
It was spitting it out, huh?
Yeah, man. I mean, we would just be like walking, you know, past all these different graves, and then it would say a name, and we'd look over at the gravestone, and it would be that name. Like, it was crazy, man.
Right, right. I mean, and that's all you can ask for, basically, in the ITC field, is if you can get any kind of name confirmation, which I usually go after my name. I want to hear my name come through that fucker. After that, I don't care. You know what I mean? Like,
yep.
If it's talking to me, then I'm happy. But, you know, at that point, I mean, you know, like Cheryl Carter out there doing her thing. You know, she's posts a lot of stuff up on her page as well with, you know, videos of interactions and stuff. I mean, so when we do these apps, and you know, because you're in the process of doing it as well, I mean, you have the best intentions for everyone to be able to get some fucking, you know, some contact and some confirmation as you're making it. But when it's done and you start testing it, the first thing you want to do is know that you're connected to the application, you know?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And when you get your name confirmation, I mean, that's, there's just nothing more clear and precise than that. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Like it just, that solidifies everything. And I haven't really ever gotten my name through any type of, you know, spirit box session before until this past couple weeks. I think I was doing a live stream and it said my name twice.
You were on Spiritus. Yeah. You were on Spiritus that night. I was watching the feed. It was incredible, dude. I mean, now, and as well, you're also testing your own ghost boxes that you're starting to build. What brought all this on, man? What made you say, I love buying this and I love owning that, but I want to make my stuff?
Yeah, very good question. So going back, I mean, even to our first conversation, the whole reason I started even making any type of gear is to be able to get it out to people at an affordable price. And, you know, just looking at eBay, what, you know, geo boxes are going for, what, you know, portals are going for and stuff. It's just ridiculous, man. I think a geo box went today for like $2,200 or something.
Yeah.
It's just crazy, man. And I just have the philosophy that I want everybody to be able to afford any type of equipment so they can do their own tests. You know what I mean? So
I got you, man.
That's kind of where it all started. Yeah.
I agree fully. The prices are ridiculous. But I do understand. It's a mutual friend of ours both actually owns. Remember on the Paranormal Lockdown season, the little black one that Nick Groff was using on the show? And he was carrying it around. You know, it's a little black handheld geo.
Oh, the geoport?
Yeah, yeah. A mutual friend of ours owns that. Now he paid, he paid into the
$2,800
for it. Right, right. Almost $3,000 for it. But I can see that because it's a piece of history.
Yep. You know? And it's the only one that was ever made like that.
Right, right. So, I mean, I can see that. Now, you just helped me sell my geoport, and when I got the geoport, dude, I gotta tell you, the nostalgia of owning a George Brown box and all that shit, I was like, oh my god, this is the mecca, this guy really does. And here's my honest take on it, man. Honest 100% take. It was over reverbed. It doesn't have any type of radio built into it whatsoever, so you have to either run your own box or your own apps off of it. So basically, it was a fucking $1,000 Bluetooth speaker. It didn't do anything, you know what I mean? It was just, it did its own thing. But when I did run anything through it, it was so, there was so much reverb in it, and you can't adjust the settings without ripping the box apart, even if there is a pedal in there. I don't know. I think he does his own reverb, but it was fucking...
Yeah, but he actually uses a spring reverb, so you can't adjust it even if you wanted to.
It was horrible. It was horrible, dude. I ran my costs through it, I ran my applications through it, and everything was so oversaturated with reverb that I couldn't fucking hear it. So, you know, and then you send me some clips of this box that you've made for your buddy, and I was like, wow, I mean, it sounds so clear just coming through the phone, coming through a Facebook message. I mean, the reverb was nice. It was there. You could hear it. And then on top of that, it wasn't oversaturated. And that's the thing about it, man. I mean, you could pay a lot of money. The gear market is retarded right now. Let's face it.
Yep.
You know, the Afterlife box that I actually got from you, very high-priced box. You know, not everybody can afford the Poltercom, but the Poltercom, I would have to say this, and I'll put my stamp on it because I love Jeremy and his stuff. The Poltercom is probably the best ghost box that you can get for the money. And if you just get a basic box, you're going to still get a good ghost box. And it's under $1,000. But
yeah, see, there's something I want to say about that too, is, you know, His Poltercoms, they can get up and get really expensive, but that's all just luxury stuff that you're adding on there.
Right.
If you get just the very basic one that's on there, I mean, it has everything you need to make it work.
Absolutely.
You're still paying less than $500.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. So, I got a couple of upgrades on my box. I got the Periscope built into it and the processor and all that. And it was under $700, around that price, you know, around there. But again, when I turn it on, I don't even have to ask anything. I hope that the audio that I played came through good enough so you could hear it saying Dybbuk and saying my name.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, holy.
Well, that very last one, Dybbuk came through very, very clear.
Right, dude. Right. And now this is an FM radio sweet box. I can't put that in there. There's no. How many fucking radio shows do you know that says Dimmy Box? Dimmy. Who the fuck says Dimmy? I'm going to tell you right now. I'm going to tell you
right
now.
Dude, I'm just going to be honest. I couldn't understand half the shit that dude was saying.
He was like a boomhauer. I'm country. He was a boomhauer.
Yeah, I'm country and I can't understand.
You know, and I, like I say, dude, I have to, you know what, I flame somebody and I don't like to do that because I see a lot of shit in this field, in this community, whatever. I don't really like even calling it a field because it's not. It's more of a community to myself. People could be offended for me not saying that it's a field, but a field is an area with profession. And I don't think that there's too many professional ghost hunters out there. And if you are pro at this, then you got some splaining to do, Lucy. You know what I mean? Because I don't know how you can be a professional in invisible things, but whatever. I mean, you can
and where nothing's been proven. I mean,
right,
you can't say you're a professional if you're not. If there's nothing proven out there, you know what I mean?
Ethically, I think you can be a pro. You can have professional ethics as far as how you respect property that you're investigating, buildings that you're investigating, especially if you're doing a fucking a public ghost hunt where you've got first-timers out there. And if you can instill it within them to take care of the area and the property and such like that, that is a very professional take on what you're doing. But I've also, you know, got the gripe with, you know, you don't have to produce anything in this field and you can charge a lot of people a lot of money to do it, you know? I mean, fuck, there was a sleepover ghost hunt here locally at a place that was like $160 a ticket, you know?
Jesus.
And
they probably let 40 people do it.
Well, huh? That was what was crazy was on the invite, there was like 60 people going. So 60 times 160, that's a fucking lot of money, dude. You know, there's the whole business side of this ruins it. It ruins it, man. You know, and dude, did you see that? Let me ask you straight up. Did you see the new Ghost Adventures yet?
Yes, I watched it this morning.
Okay.
I couldn't watch it last night. I was investigating myself. But first thing when I woke up this morning, I turned it on.
All right. That's cool. I watched it as it happened. And I actually was up fucking around on my phone, so I caught it as it replayed, too. But the whole part where Zach starts acting like he's possessed and he's got that stupid smirk on his face and he's giggling and he's arguing with the big fat girl. I mean, isn't there a point to where somebody somewhere goes, this is fucking bullshit? Isn't there a line that we all need to say, okay, Zach's acting? And it's so funny that when he was doing that, that fucking laugh, how he's looking, he looks over to the camera to make sure he's in the shot.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Yep. It takes so much of the legitimacy away of the hard work that people put into this to actually want to make contact. And I, you know, I had it out with Scott Grunewald over the fucking Ghost Adventures bullshit. I like the show. I'm entertained by it. But don't be offended when I say, that's fucking bullshit. You know, the answer isn't, well, there's a turnoff knob. No. Yeah, you're right, there is. But there's also a turn-on knob. And it's turning fucking on, and a bunch of people are watching this shit go down. I love the entertainment, and it's the same thing with Steve Huff. Holy fucking Huff, dude. This guy has lost his mind, dude. Now he's got Jesus on his side, and he's doing all this shit. And you see where the entertainment side of it takes. You know, Steve Huff has got God in his corner. He doesn't allow any negative spirits or anything like that. And you got Zach Bagans fucking going out there and being possessed and acting like he's going to fight a big fat girl. And it's just like, where does it stop, dude? That's the entertainment side of it. But in reality, when a person goes on a ghost hunt for real, and we're out in this fucking cold place, and there's bugs crawling all over us, The air conditioning doesn't work or the heater doesn't work. You're freezing your ass off. You got snot sickles and you need to take a shit. This is not fucking Hollywood, okay? This is not Hollywood. This is the real fucking side of it. And it ain't cool. There ain't no possession going on. It's fucking, you're sitting there and you're waiting for any type of contact.
Yeah, and well, the thing is, you know, when you put yourself on a national recognized, you know, television show like that, you got to be open to criticism either way. So for the dude to trip out when you say something is ridiculous to begin with.
No, he tripped.
And and then, you know, also, like, you know, just being part of the entertainment side, like, you got to think it's either one side of the spectrum or the other. Anything that's kind of in between there is not as exciting. So that's why Zach is really good at playing the demonic side on everything. And I'm sorry, I can't believe that. I still love the show. Right. I've watched every episode.
I have too.
I'm going to continue to watch the show. There's
absolutely
nothing probably going to stop me.
Absolutely.
You know? But at the end of the day, I take that with a grain of salt, and I don't apply any of those practices into my investigation style.
Okay. You know? I'll put it this way. When I was young, I was heavily involved in the martial arts. Very, very involved. Okay. Like, everything was Bruce Lee and Chuck Norris, dude, for me as a kid.
Nice.
I practiced and did my shit, okay? The first time I ever got in a fight, I remember it like it just happened 5 minutes ago. And this is the difference between a real fight and a kung fu fight, okay? You watch the Kung Fu Theater, you watch the Bruce Lee, the Chuck Norris, and they're standing there and they got that cool stance and they throw the fucking punch. And when it hits the dude, it goes, whoosh, right? So
yeah.
I threw my punch and I hit the kid in the face and it didn't do that. I was like, wait a minute. Where's my, I want my fucking sound effects. This is
not, why didn't he launch 6 feet back?
Right, exactly. He didn't do a backflip or anything. I hit him in the face and he's still standing there. Holy shit, I'm in a fight. You know? Yeah. But when you watch
reality slapped you in the face.
Yeah, right. When you're watching the reality and you're watching Hollywood, then you know, in Hollywood, fucking motherfuckers coming doing backflips, doing double nunchucks and fucking getting down. But in real life, if you try that, you're going to get fucked up. So that's what my point is I love the entertainment side of everything. I really do. And when I watch it, it makes me want to go out on Ghost Hunt. It makes me want to go to the cemetery right down the road from my house. Every time I watch Ghost Adventures, I'm like, I'm taking my ghost box and going to the fucking cemetery. You know, because I want to make contact. Yep. I think that they're great entertainers. I think Steve Huff is a great entertainer. But they don't label themselves that, man. They fucking come off like they're legit, and that gets on my nerves. And that's why I'm so boisterous about what I'm watching and what somebody who's watching is going to expect. You know what I mean? Like
because that's oftentimes what happens when, especially when we go to these residential cases where they don't have any experience with any of this, and they're just needing help, and they expect what they see on TV, and it's just. Oftentimes, it's just not the same thing at all.
Right. How many times have you drove for hours, spent a good few $100 on gas, batteries, getting all your stuff, you know, taking time off work to go out and do this, and you get to a location and nothing?
A lot. It happens a lot.
Right. And, you know, for every week for a motherfucker to go from location to location, location, and just have the most incredible type of contact going on. I mean, people need to realize that as well. You are not going to have contact on every single location that you're at. It's just reality. It's the way that it is. But, you know, even if you are in an active spot, maybe they don't want to talk to you. You know?
Yep, and that very well could just be the case. They're there. They're listening. They may be standing right beside us and just don't want to say anything.
Right. You know? I mean, you know, Christopher Ostrowski told me best, you know. He goes, you know, you go into a location and, you know, these people, you know, that live with haunted houses or whatever, you know, you're in the ghost's house. You're walking into their house and you're screaming at them, "Show yourself!" Let me see if I can show yourself. Oh, my reverb wasn't on. Fuck, I gotta fix that. But you know, when you start screaming that shit about showing yourself and being, you know, oh, come on, man, the Van Helsing thing and the whole Zach Bagans thing, it's overplayed. It's overplayed, you know. And when you get somebody, you know, like I got somebody who's really popular in the field, like Scott Grunewald, all pissed off at me because I said that I didn't like that fucking Pawn Stars episode where they're, you know, basically greasing up Zach's museum to fucking, you know. It's frustrating to me because I don't want that message being spread on to somebody who's thinking about getting in the field or in the community or going out on a ghost hunt, you know. But when we talk about the cost of things, you know, that's a whole different side of the fucking world, man. I mean, it is expensive to go out and do this shit, and I don't think people take that into consideration. So I have the soft side of me for the public ghost hunts because, you know, if you go out and you have a team and you have your gear on display for those people to use and to be able to experience what they're doing, then I believe you should be compensated fully. I believe that, you know, you're being a tour guide, you know, you're taking people into a Honda location. So, yeah, I can see, get compensated for that. But, you know, when people just start fucking putting a ghost hunt together anywhere and every ticket's $40, $50, $60, you know, fuck, dude. You know, you got to think that if you're charging people and you don't produce, those people are going to tell two people, that those two people are going to tell four people, and it just goes out that, oh, this is all bullshit.
Yep. You know, I saw an ad on Facebook just the other day of the Nick Groff tour where he goes and he does these public hunts where people can join him. It was like $225 plus an extra $30 if you wanted to do the meet and greet.
Right.
I mean, dude.
Right.
Oh, my God.
Per person.
Yeah.
And so basically what they're saying is you can go hunt with Nick Groff for $200, but for $30 more, you can even talk to him. You know what I mean?
Hey, man. Hey, I guess take it where you can, but geez,
right.
That's,
I mean,
crazy,
and you know he's making most of that money. I mean,
or
they've paid him such an absurd amount to go hunt that location that they have to charge that to be able to afford having him there in the first place. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
So, you know, and here's the deal, man. You celebrity ghost hunters are so far beyond what we start for. I believe that if anybody's a celebrity, they don't give a fuck about making contact. They care about making a good show. And the minute the show business takes over, then just consider yourself an entertainer. Don't try to tell the community that you're still a serious ghost hunter. And then, you know, you remember that shit about Aaron coming out and telling him in an interview where he was telling people that the fucking producers from the show put them up to doing stuff. And he was allegedly fired from Ghost Adventures for this interview that he gave. I guess he was fucked up and he just let a little bit too much out in the interview. Which is why
I heard something about it. Yeah.
Which is why I think that you don't ever hear any interviews from these fucking guys doing anything other than on TV.
They don't want to get caught slipping, and they don't want to get taken out of the world that they portray themselves to be in. Right. So, I mean, here's another aspect of it. I mean, even going back to Nick Groff, he's doing these investigations where you can go meet him, whatever. Zach Bagans doesn't do that. None of them on Ghost Adventures do that. There's a reason for that, you know? And then... Right. I mean, there has to be a reason for that. There's, you know,
well,
I mean, he's making a ton of money doing what he's doing. Trust me, I get it. Maybe he doesn't have to do that, and he's got other things going on. But
and like on that,
there's a reason.
Like in the episode that we just watched, where they're at the Vortex, and they're talking about we contacted every witch, you know, community here to talk to us, and nobody would. That's because they think you're full of fucking shit, and they don't want to be portrayed in the wrong way.
Yep, because you don't have any control over that, you know?
Right.
He does. He can chop up that video to whatever he wants you to say.
Well, as a matter of fact, As a matter of fact, I'm not going to say any names right now, but I'm working on a show right now. A friend of mine, Bonnie, actually hooked me up on this show. And these were some ladies that were actually featured on Ghost Adventures, and they're very unhappy with how they were portrayed. They don't like it. They're going to come on. They're going to tell me the real of what's going on. I'm going to go investigate their place and enjoy some time with them. But exactly. You go on camera and you say what you want to say, and then they take it to the editing room and they fucking dice it and they cut it up. And the end product that they're happy with, you have full sentences and paragraphs taken out of things that you say about you or your business or about what you believe. And if they decide to leave that in there, then it's fine. Then they get the truth. But if they take that out, then you're standing there looking like you're in fucking La La Land wondering what the fuck, you know? So, I mean, that's the whole paranormal TV thing. And I think that the people that are out there making their shows and doing the things that they do, you know, you got to be careful with how you portray the people. Just because they open the door to let you in to investigate doesn't mean that you're allowed to rag on them, too. I also heard another rumor, you know, about Zach where a certain person wouldn't do some shit that he wanted him to recreate, and he got pissed off about that, you know? So if you have morals and you don't want them portrayed in a negative way, then, you know, the best thing to do is not be a part of it. So I took my hat off and saluted the witch community for telling Ghost Adventures to fuck off.
Yep. Yep.
You know? So anyways, let's get back to your gear, man. I know that you said that you're doing this thing to be affordable, but I mean, in all due respect, man, I mean, your shit sounds awesome. It really does. What's the whole approach?
Well, that's kind of another thing. You know, when I was going back looking at, you know, George Brown's boxes, I've never owned one. I've never even used one. So I don't know from person what they sound like, but you know, I'll just go back and watch videos that, you know, people post of what's, you know, what you're hearing. And what I'm hearing through the video is exactly what you explained earlier. It is way over reverbed, and that is probably really, really hard to hear in real time. You know, I mean, most of that, you're going to have to go back and rewatch it and slow it down.
It was insane. Understand it. It was so horrible. Yeah. It was just nothing that I was like, this is really bad. That's why it was instant for me to say, yeah, I'm getting rid of this. You know, going against the Afterlight box, the Afterlight box fucking destroyed the Geoport. Now, I don't know how it is against the Geo box because that's a different beast. But yeah. I would be willing to put it up against it just as it is, as my box is right now. I would be willing to put that up against any $10,000 Geo box, because I honestly believe that the ingredient in this box is correct. And it's showing me that.
It is a very good box.
Yeah, man. It's showing me that by the replies. I mean, we watched our friend Nick get destroyed by this shit coming out of this box one night. We just kind of sat there just kind of going, fuck, Nick, it don't like you today. Nick from Paranormal Disorder. We turned this box on at Leslie's Family Tree our last time there, and it just told Nick exactly what it thought of him. And it picked on him the whole night. Said his name, said he was evil, and then it said a full sentence as he asked it back and said, what, you think I'm evil? The box actually said back, yeah, I think you're evil. I was like, holy shit, dude. You know, he's even got that on video, you know?
That's what I'm saying. Every bit of this is on video.
Right. Everything's captured. And I'm sitting there just dumbfounded because as far as my apps go, I'm used to one or two words back as far as an answer goes. And you might have to wait a couple of seconds in between, but you get the end point, you know? But this fucking second that we were there, it said the full sentence straight to him in a reply. And it's the longest, clearest sentence I've ever heard in ITC as far as a reply goes. And that's me. I'm sure somebody else has got more out there to talk about. But on that situation, it was insane, dude. Insane.
Yeah, that was a crazy night. And just going over the footage from that night, I was just blown away. Like every 3 seconds, it was just something else, you know?
Right. So, and we were missing it. We were missing it being there, you know, and then you start playing the tapes back and you're like, wait a minute, they were really putting the smack down up on Nick.
Yeah, they were.
Nick took a week off, I think, afterwards. He was so drained because it wasn't just...
He did.
Yeah. It wasn't even just a verbal. It was they were just attached to him. They had their hooks sunk in him and just made him, you know, not a very happy guy for a week. He was like, I need to take a break. And I totally understood it and respected it, dude, because we witnessed it. They were smacking him around.
Yep. And sometimes you do. You just need to clear your head, you know, and then get back rolling. The thing is, you can't let it keep you down too long. You got to get up and go.
Yeah,
you
know? Right. I mean, well, the same thing with the executioner's box. You know, I think that we're on 3 versions different from the one that I use now. I think it's been edited and changed up a little bit about 3 or 4 times since I turned that app on that night. And, you know, I've tested every one of the new ones that are out, but I always go back and load my first version in because of what happened to me using that application. And I know that it was in direct result of using that. People can go, you're crazy. That's not what happened. No, but it's what happened. Because my house was straight. You know, well, you've got Demi boxes in your house.
Oh, my God. Not at that time.
You know, you got Demi boxes in your house and you know, there's shit going on and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, there is now. But at that time, it was pretty quiet here. And it didn't just affect me. It was the whole house. The animals, the children, the wife, everything. Everybody was affected at what they fucking heard and saw. So, you know, I go back to that version of it. But when you put these things out there, you know, you're expecting people just to, you know, to use them responsibly and all that stuff. But the crazier the shit you put out there, the crazier people are going to get with it. That's all there is to it.
Yep.
You know? So,
yep, and with the influence that's out there, again, what you see on TV
right.
is already a little bit,
right.
you know,
right.
a little bit over the top, you know.
So. Believe me, man, I'll tell you this as far as one of my ghost stories. I was literally chased down the road by my best friend with a screwdriver in his hand, swinging it at me to plunge this 12-inch long screwdriver through my back, and he was completely overtaken by something that we were messing with. Was these books? They weren't satanic books, but they were I would say more of a devil worship side of books. There's a big difference between being a Satanist and being a devil worshiper. Big difference.
Yeah,
we fucked around and said some of these spells, and I've seen this guy become completely overtaken by this thing, and it chased me down the road a good 100 yards dash. I mean, and I was young at the time, so I could make that run. Now, you know, if anybody asked me to fucking run, I'd say why, and then if there was somebody chasing me with a screwdriver, I'm just going to shoot you, and it's over with. You know what I mean? The game's over. But as a kid in the, you know, 12, 13-year-old range where, you know, I ran. And when we stopped running, we got a distance away from the place we were at, and I stopped after. He stopped, and I stopped probably about another 20 or 30 steps after I could see him not chasing me anymore. And I stopped, and I'm just hunched over my knees, and I'm trying to put air in my lungs. And he just was standing there looking at me with this look on his face. And he wasn't out of breath. He wasn't overexerted. He just was there, dude. And you know, I saw the life come back into him. And as he's looking at himself going, what just happened? Kind of a deal, you know? And I'm just like, you just tried to fucking kill me, bro. You know what I mean? Whatever you just smoked, it's really bad. But, you know, at the time, we were so young and we're dabbling in these things and reading the books and chanting the spells and calling anything forward that we could, that we didn't realize that it actually would work. We didn't think that. We were just like, you know, couple of stoner kids going, ha, 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 I just said, come forward, demon. And then the motherfucking demon came forward, and our day was ruined. I mean, it could have been really bad if I would have been stabbed or dead in the process. You know what I mean? It could have gone really, really, really bad. But I know from the scream. I mean, dude, and he was screaming as he was chasing after me, too. It wasn't just like he was quiet running. He had this screech scream going on. And I wasn't saying shit. I had my chin pointed up at the sky because I was just running so hard. You know what I mean? To try and get away. But when you look back at these type of things and then you see somebody like Zach or these fucking shows that come out and they make people being possessed kind of entertainment or cool or it took over. Yeah, listen, man, there's a huge possibility that you going out to a haunted site and asking for things to happen, it could really happen. And when you're overtaken, you don't know what you're going to do. It's not cool. And I think that Zach pretending to be, you know, possessed and then walking out, oh, I've got to go outside. And then he goes outside and he's kneeling there waiting for the camera to come around the corner to get him in the shot. You know, for people that actually go out that aren't on TV and start doing this shit, it usually seems to be a little bit worse because it's real, you know? Possession.
Yeah. And
go ahead, brother.
Sorry.
No, you're good.
Now, I just noticed another thing when I was watching that episode, the latest one from yesterday. And what I thought was also very interesting, you remember the part where the deer ran across the field there and they just freaked out?
How he did? Yeah, he broke off. He was going to fucking run for the 100-yard dash.
Yes, look at that. And that was just a deer. But then look at what his reaction is when things are going off in these places. You know, it's not the same.
Right.
It's not even close to the same. And he freaked out over a deer.
Now, you know? living where you live and living where I live, we have that a lot. We can hear that through the woods, and we go instantly. We identify it as a deer, an elk, or whatever, you know, or just wild animal. But you know, he fucking he was like, ah!
He was getting the hell out of there,
and he was fucking bright. He was breaking out, dude. He was breaking out to me, and then you know, as everybody starts laughing because night vision catches what it is. But this is a professional 16-season fucking ghost adventure guy. A deer jumps up and Zach Baggins shits himself. Let's be real.
It's so true, dude. As soon as I saw it, I was like, how is his reaction so much stronger over a deer?
Right, right. You know, yeah. And pretty much, I'll be honest with you, on Saturdays, I think that Ghost Adventures pretty much dominates my television from 4 o'clock till around midnight. I got my TV in the studio, and I just let it fucking go and just listen. And, you know, sometimes I look over and I, you know, this all goes back to the brick. This all goes back to the brick for me. That him and Nick were at this place that Aaron just couldn't be at. And then the brick levitated and shit fucking flew around and stuff got broken. And
oh, yeah, that was like Virginia City or something.
Yeah, it was somewhere in Nevada.
Goldfield Hotel.
Yeah, it was Goldfield. And I saw all that shit happen. And then I just went to myself, okay, now looking back, I got to call bullshit. I do. I got to call bullshit, man. I wanted to believe that it was real for so long. And then I saw some debunking videos on YouTube on how they did it. And, you know, the brick was actually a fucking piece of foam that was painted. And there's so much stuff on there.
No.
But, you know, how I looked at it was like maybe Aaron wasn't in the show because he needed to pull the wires.
Yep.
You know, because he wasn't there. He wasn't in the episode, and they went out and did an episode without him, and all of a sudden sticks and fucking shit's floating around and getting thrown. And, you know, man, I was just so amazed with that. It was actually a part of their documentary before they actually, it wasn't an actual episode. It was their documentary.
Their original documentary, yeah.
And I just wanted to go, wow, you know, would they okay. How bad do you want to be famous? Should we stage some really crazy shit, catch it on some night vision that you ain't going to see anything but movement, you know, the main part of shit. So you didn't have to have a high budget to pull that off. And I just have to think to myself, I think it's pretty possible that they did that in their first foremost film to get them. That's what got them the TV series was them. Yep. You know, they got the dude walking across the Washoe Club, which, you know, I've been to Virginia City and I'm not impressed, bro. I wasn't impressed. I was there in the season. There were kids and families and shit going all over the place. Now, I did have a couple of situations happen to me there. I did catch a burn, and I did catch a whole bunch of light anomalies. Damn, you breaking shit. But, yeah, you know, I caught my shit, you know, and it was like, wow, this is crazy. But to the level that everything seems to be caught on at Virginia City, how many times can you hunt a public attraction and they just continue to reproduce? Don't you think that that's kind of weird, dude?
I say it all the time, man. There's only so much energy, you know? There's only so much. And right. If it's continuously hunted like that, I mean, there's only so much it can do, you know?
Right. I mean, you know, and I think, you know, with the residential thing and, you know, people that live there or people that frequent the businesses, yeah, I believe that the activity can feed off of those people. Mm-hmm. But it just seems like every crew that goes to Virginia City catches the new biggest new thing that's going on there. Like the activity is not just continuing, but it's actually getting worse because that's how it's being portrayed to me as I watch stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know, Virginia City haters and all that. Yeah, I'm not hating it. I just think that it's like I went to Disneyland for ghost hunters. We'll be back in 2 minutes. We're gonna play some commercials. You know, I've wasted a lot of money in this business. I really have. I've got a whole case of things that I don't ever use. I mean, they're paperweights. I got them. They got cool looking lights, but they never do anything for me on location. And that's exactly where I come in right here with my favorite company, Paranologies. At Paranologies.com, you can get anything that you're looking for, man. They've got sensors, cameras, audio, lighting, accessories, and even DVRs, man. Their sensors are second to none, period. The 360 periscope, the regular periscope, the electroscope, the pyramid, the geopod, the temperscope, the periscope plasma, the tribometer, the thermoscope. Holy shit, there's a lot of scopes going on out here. Plus the holy grail of them all, the Poltercom and the Poltercom progeny. Don't waste another dime on unnecessary gear. Get a hold of Jeremy Jones at Paranologies.com and get what you deserve in your arsenal. Get results. Paranologies.com. Hey guys, what's going on? This is Dave with 51 Areas Paranormal Talk Radio. If you happen to be in the market for your very own SLS camera, I have found the hidden treasure in the field. Landon and Jerry of the Paranormal Response Team are doing something incredible for all investigators, single or with your team. To your door, you can get your very own SLS camera shipped to your house for $299. And it's incredible because not only do they send you the camera, they send you a couple of videos, show you how to use it. And if you have any questions, you just contact them and their customer service is through the roof. They will help you out. I'm talking through experience here dealing with these guys. They are 100% class and they're doing something great because the technology that you're paying for is just outrageous on some of these sites. But to your door, $299 shipped. And you're on your way. Then you can be just like Zach. Just like Zach.
Fuck Zach.
Tell him I sent you, man. Paranormal Response Team on Facebook. Boats and Hoes all day long. We are on the paranormal SS Minnow right now, just having a little bit of rap about what it is we don't like about what's going on, or what is that we like. It's just a bullshit session. You know what I mean, Lennon? You know what I mean?
Yeah. I actually heard the music this time. It was awesome.
But I mean, you know, it there's so many good things about this community. There really is. There's a lot of great people out there with good hearts like yourself that want to help people out. I mean, the SLS camera that you make, dude, wow, that was my communicator. That was the Enterprise trying to get a hold of me. But I mean, it's like, it's when you listen to it, man, and you're a part of what's going on, and you're viewing this shit like that little fucking video that I took at Family Tree, where that figure jumped on the wall and then it went up to the ceiling and it's fucking ripping across. I'm just like, you just can't do that. People that don't understand, and the SLS camera right now, the Kinect cams are being ripped apart by these naysayer groups right now out there trying to discredit what they're about. So I want to give you a little bit more opportunity to, because you know I've got the SLS the commercial for you guys, and I play it every single show because I know how fantastic the gear is. But what was your take on when you said, I want to do this Bill Chappell thing that he's doing that doesn't cost people thousands of dollars?
Well, you know, that's the main reason is I didn't want to pay $1,000 for my team to have one. Like I've told you before, I built the very first one just for us.
Right.
You know, and then other people saw it through videos or in person or whatnot, and then had me build them one. And then I was like, well, let me just post these up and see if there's some other people that want them. So that's really kind of how it started with that. But, you know, going back to these people that are discrediting it as legit evidence or whatnot, I mean, you kind of have to take everything as kind of experimental to begin with.
Right.
You know, there's nothing 100% proven in this field. That's why I don't really believe there's experts. You know, there you can't be an expert in something that you don't know anything
right.
about. You know,
right.
You can learn from your experiences what you're going through and what, you know, what happened here and what happened there. But at the end of the day, there's no set rules.
Right.
They don't play by rules.
Right.
You know.
Well, and you know, this weekend I have an event that I'm going to actually be attending with the Paranormal Disorder guys. I'm going to have your camera on display, and we're going to use it and let everybody be able to grab it and run around. I'm actually going to let people use it hands-on so they can get a view of exactly what's going on with it. So if something does get mapped falsely, they can figure out to move it or whatever, but I plan on showing this camera that I stand by 100%, so people can actually get their hands on it and see how it works. So it's going to be interesting.
That's awesome, man.
Oh yeah, for sure, man. It's going to be an interesting weekend. I know that the show wasn't supposed to happen, and it was just kind of a bullshit session. And I know you're pressed for time, so I'm going to let you get up off of here, and you'll have plenty of video to see people using your cameras. I'm going to film them as they're using it.
Good, man. It's awesome. I just once you use it, you're going to love it.
Right.
You know? And that's just one piece. I mean, there's tons of other things you can get, but there's just something that's really neat about that, being able to put a figure to
right.
The massive energy that's there. It's crazy to be able to actually visually see it.
I believe that the first time we used your camera there, I believe it was the first time that technology has been in the family tree. So,
wow.
Yeah, so I don't think anybody's taken anyone in there. As far as I remember back, Corey said that she had never seen one in there. So, you know, I think that was the first time. So this weekend coming up again, I'm going to bring it in there and hopefully downstairs. You know, we didn't ever take it downstairs. So I want to take it down there and see what we can catch in the basement. But Landon Wells of the Paranormal Response Team, man, I appreciate you coming on just for a little bit of shit shooting and some demi box conversations and all that good stuff, man.
So, yeah, Dave, yeah, man, I appreciate it, man. Thank
Absolutely.
You. And next time we'll have to do this much longer. We got to beat our 3-hour records.
Right, for sure. I know it's early. I know it's early. It wasn't planned, man. I just was kind of sitting here watching my team lose and was like, I want to play these messages for people and let them hear the audio that I received on my Demi box. And, you know, But anyways, brother, I appreciate your time and for jumping on with me here, and we'll wrap at you soon, brother.
Awesome, Dave. Thanks, man. Have a good night.
You too, buddy.
Bye-bye.
Peace. So just like that. Just like that. Good dude. I'm looking forward. I'm going to actually travel to his neck of the woods in November. Oh, man, it's going to be crazy. We're going to hunt on a plantation, slave plantation. God almighty, that's just hardcore. But, I came on, I set some shit straight, and I said what was on my mind. If that offends you, I apologize, but it's kind of what I do. I just talk about what I want to say. It's my show.
Thanks for tuning in to 51 Areas Paranormal Talk Radio. See you next week.
Another owner, you go start a bunch of shit there. I'll make sure the other guy let him know the same thing. She didn't start no shit. She just was having a freak about being the no dingy box. And you will start this shit here. You don't want none. Trust me.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening you.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening nobody.
Oh,
I'm telling you, you don't want none.
Oh.
Okay?
I do.
And you think I'm going to apologize?
I do want some.
For her telling the truth, you think I'm going to apologize by letting y'all know that she told the truth about something? You want to go on the radio and out people? Go right ahead. Because I will come on the radio and I will take and have your dingy box you pull out as experts verify. That is not a dandy box. And then you can yell at them and holler, oh, they're causing trouble. All she did was tell the truth, dude. And keep on. I'll have your fucking show taken off the fucking air.
Oh.
Don't think I won't.
Oh.
I got that kind of power. Don't fuck with me.
Wow.
Okay? I'm trying to do this peaceful. And you can come at me sideways like that. So just talk to me like a real fucking man.
Real.
Think you're bad or something? You ain't bad. Neither am I.
Ow.
The bad ones is the ones you can't see.
Oh.
But you know what? The one you can't see, don't fuck with me.
Whatever.
End of message.
End of message. You know, I actually have to pause at the stupidity that you all just heard. You all just heard. It's a dammit box. It ain't a dammit box. Motherfucker sounds like Les Claypool from Primus. Dammit was a race car driver. You know what I mean? Come on, man. Okay, so I got that message, and he's gonna get my show taken off the air. Lloyd, douchebag, hillbilly, you ain't doing shit. Okay, that's why I'm using your name right here, right now. If those are your words. You said this shit. When it comes to Maggie White. We actually were friends at a point, and she did come on the show a couple few times. You know what I mean? But here's the thing. This chick fucking hit me up before all this stuff jumped off with my friend. And she actually told me this. And I'm going to tell you this. This is how disturbing this Facebook Messenger call was that I got from her. She started trying to call up Rod Farrell, and he's one of the makers of one of the Dybbuk boxes that I'm... The Dimmy boxes. The Dimmy box. And he's in prison. He's a very well-known killer who was apprehended for his crimes, and, you know, yeah. He paid,
yep.
You know, he paid into the...
$2,800
right,
for it.
Right, right. Almost $3,000 yep. for it. But I can see that because it's a piece of history.
Yep.
You know?
And it's the only one that was ever made like that.
Right, right. So, I mean, I can see that. Now, you just helped me sell my Geoport. And when I got the Geoport, dude, I got to tell you, the nostalgia of owning a George Brown box and all that shit, I was like, oh, my God, this is the mecca. This guy really does... And here's my honest take on it, man. Honest 100% take. It was over-reverbed. It doesn't have any type of radio built into it whatsoever, so you have to either run your own box or your own apps off of it. So basically, it was a fucking $1,000 Bluetooth speaker. It didn't do anything.
Yep.
You know what I mean? It was just, mm-hmm. it did its own thing. But when I did run anything through it, it was so, there was so much reverb in it, and you can't adjust the settings without ripping the box apart, even if there is a pedal in there. I don't know. I think he does his own reverb, but it was fucking...
Yeah, but he actually uses a spring reverb, so yeah. You can't adjust it even if you wanted to.
It was horrible. It was horrible, dude. I ran my costs through it, I ran my applications through it, and everything was so oversaturated with reverb that I couldn't fucking hear it. So, you know, and then you send me some clips of this box that you've made for your buddy, and I was like, wow, I mean, it sounds so clear just coming through the phone, coming through a Facebook message. I mean, the reverb was nice. It was there. You could hear it. And then on top of that, it wasn't oversaturated. And that's the thing about it, man. I mean, you could pay a lot of money. The gear market is retarded right now. Let's face it.
Yep.
You know, the Afterlife box that I actually got from you, very high-priced box. You know, not everybody can afford the Poltercom, but the Poltercom, I would have to say this, and I'll put my stamp on it because I love Jeremy and his stuff. The Poltercom is probably the best ghost box that you can get for the money. And if you just get a basic box, you're going to still get a good ghost box. And it's under $1,000. But
yeah, see, there's something I want to say about that too, is, you know, His Poltercoms, they can get up and get really expensive, but that's all just luxury stuff that you're adding on there.
Right.
If you get just the very basic one that's on there, I mean, it has everything you need to make it work.
Absolutely.
You're still paying less than $500.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. So, I got a couple of upgrades on my box. I got the
entertainment side. Like, you got to think. It's either one side of the spectrum or the other. Anything that's kind of in between there is not as exciting. So that's why Zach is really good at playing the demonic side on everything. And I'm sorry, I can't believe that. I still love the show.
Right.
I've watched every episode.
I have too.
I'm going to continue to watch the show. There's
absolutely.
Nothing probably going to stop me.
Absolutely.
You know? But at the end of the day, I take that with a grain of salt, and I don't apply any of those practices into my investigation style.
Okay. You know? I'll put it this way. When I was young, I was heavily involved in the martial arts. Very. Very involved, okay? Like, everything was Bruce Lee and Chuck Norris, dude, for me as a kid.
Nice.
I practiced and did my shit, okay? The first time I ever got in a fight, I remember it like it just happened 5 minutes ago. And this is the difference between a real fight and a kung fu fight, okay? You watch the Kung Fu Theater, you watch the Bruce Lee, the Chuck Norris, and they're standing there and they got that cool stance and they throw the fucking punch, and when it hits the dude, it goes whoosh, right? So
yeah.
I threw my punch and I hit the kid in the face and it didn't do that. I was like, wait a minute, where's my I want my fucking sound effects. This is
why didn't he launch 6 feet back?
Right, exactly. He didn't do a backflip or anything. I hit him in the face and he's still standing there. Holy shit, I'm in a fight. You know? Yeah. But when you watch
reality slaps you in the face.
Yeah, right. When you're watching reality and you're watching Hollywood, then you know, in Hollywood, fucking motherfuckers come in doing backflips, doing double nunchucks and fucking getting down. But in real life, if you try that, you're going to get fucked up. So that's what my point is I love the entertainment side of everything. I really do. And when I watch it, it makes me want to go out and ghost hunt. It makes me want to go to the cemetery right down the road from my house. Every time I watch Ghost Adventures, I'm like, I'm taking my ghost box and going to the fucking cemetery. You know, because I want to make contact.
Yep.
I think that they're great entertainers. I think Steve Huff is a great entertainer. But they don't label themselves that, man. They fucking come off like they're legit, and that gets on my nerves. And that's why I'm so boisterous about what I'm watching and what somebody who's watching is going to expect. You know what I mean? Like, you
yep.
don't...
Because that's oftentimes what happens, especially when we go to these residential cases where they don't have any experience with any of this, and they're just needing help, and they expect what they see on TV, and it's just... Oftentimes, it's just not the same thing at all.
Right. How many times... He calls it a demi box.
That ain't even a real demi box. That ain't even a real demi box, boy. Maggie.
Yeah, okay. So, I've given you enough of that. I'm going to fucking hit my voicemail here on my phone so you can hear exactly. Hang on, cancel. Okay, there we go. Now we're going to dial out. I don't know exactly how this is going to work. It's the first time I've ever played a voicemail.
Listen, press 1, send.
There you go.
First saved message.
You want to talk to me? Answer your phone next time I call you? No, we can discuss this problem that you got currently with Maggie and me, Lloyd Kelly. Because understand something. All she got was try to help you or protect you and your family at your request, and then turn around and all that she did then was tell the truth about that is not a demi box.
A demi box.
Okay. She didn't know they're on there. You go start a bunch of shit there. I was making sure the other guy let him know the same thing. She didn't start no shit. She just was telling the truth about it being no demi box. And you go start this shit here. You don't want none. Trust me.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening you.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening nobody.
Oh, I'm scared.
I'm telling you, you don't want none.
Oh.
Okay. And you think I'm going to apologize? For her telling the truth, you think I'm going to apologize by letting y'all know that she told the truth about something? You want to go on the radio and out people? Go right ahead. Because I will come on the radio and I will take and have your demi box you pull out as experts verify that it's not a demi box. And then you can yell at them and holler, oh, they're calling trouble. All she did was tell the truth, dude. And keep on. I'll have your fucking show taken off the fucking air.
Oh.
Don't think I won't.
Oh.
I got that kind of power. Don't fuck with me.
Wow.
Okay? I'm trying to do this peaceful, and you come at me sideways like that, and so just talk to me like a real fucking man.
Real fucking
think you're bad or something? You ain't bad. Neither am I.
Ow.
The bad ones is the ones you can't see.
Ooh.
But you know what? The ones you can't see, don't fuck with me.
Whatever.
End of message.
End of message. You know... I actually have to pause at the stupidity that you all just heard. You all just heard. It's a demi box. It ain't a demi box. Motherfucker sounds like Les Claypool from Primus. Demi was a race car driver. You know what I mean? Come on, man. Okay. So I got that message and he's going to get my show taken off the air, Lloyd. And he leaves this voicemail. And listen, I have my ringer off on my phone because of all the notifications and everything that go through Facebook, whether I get messages from Twitter, Facebook, or on the show site. I get a lot of messages, so I fucking turn it off so it doesn't go off all night long, right? Happy life, happy wife, happy life kind of a thing. Because when my phone goes off fucking 24/7, yeah, shit happens. So this fucking doofus calls me up, Lloyd Kelly, you fucking doofus, calls me up and leaves this message on my phone. And he's so fucking stupid that he's not even calling it a Dybbuk box. Listen to this fucking hillbilly. Listen to this guy. He calls it a demi box.
That ain't even a real demi box. That ain't even a real demi box, boy. Maggie.
Yeah, okay. So, I've given you enough of that. I'm going to fucking hit my voicemail here on my phone so you can hear exactly. Hang on, cancel. Okay, there we go. Now we're going to dial out. I don't know exactly how this is going to work. It's the first time I've ever played a voicemail.
Listen, press 1, send.
There you go.
First saved message.
This message is to say you're here. You want to talk to me? Answer your phone next time I call you? No, we can discuss this problem that you got currently with Maggie and me, Lloyd Kelly. Because her, understand something. All she does is try to help you or take you and your family at your request, and then
lie.
Turn around and
lie.
All that she did then was tell the truth about that is not a demi box.
A demi box.
Okay. She had been wrong there. You go start a bunch of shit there. I'll make sure the other guy let him know the same thing. She didn't start no shit. She just was having a freak about it being no demi box. And you go start this shit here. You don't want none. Trust me.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening you.
Ooh.
I'm not threatening nobody.
Oh, I'm
telling you, you don't want none.
Oh.
Okay.
I do.
You think I'm going to apologize?
I want some.
For her telling the truth, you think I'm going to apologize by letting y'all know that she told the truth about something? You want to go on the radio and out people? So let her hear it. Because I will come on the radio and I will take and have your demi box you pull out as experts verify that it's not a demi box. And then you can yell at them and holler, oh, they're causing trouble. All she did was tell the truth, dude. And keep on. I'll have your fucking show taken off the fucking air.
Oh.
Don't think I won't.
Oh.
I got that kind of power. Don't fuck with me.
Wow.
Okay? I'm trying to do this peaceful. You were kind of me sideways like that, so just pop.
Yep.
Whatever. I mean, you could have.
And where nothing's been proven. I mean,
right,
you can't say you're a professional if you're not. If there's nothing proven out there. You
ethically,
know what I mean?
Ethically, I think you can be a pro. You can have professional ethics as far as how you respect property
yes.
that you're investigating, buildings that you're investigating, especially if you're doing a fucking a public ghost hunt where you've got first timers out there. And if you can instill it within them to take care of the area and the property and such like that, that is a very professional take on what you're doing. But I've also, you know, got the gripe with, you know, you don't have to produce anything in this field and you can charge a lot of people a lot of money to do it, you know? I mean, fuck, there was a sleepover ghost hunt here locally at a place that was like $160 a ticket. You know,
Jesus.
And
they probably let 40 people do it.
Well,
huh?
That was what was crazy was on the invite there was like 60 people going. So 60 times 160, that's a fucking lot of money, dude. You know, there's the whole business side of this ruins it. It ruins it, man. You know, and dude, did you see that? Let me ask you straight up. Did you see the new Ghost Adventures yet?
Yes, I watched it this morning.
Okay.
I couldn't watch it last night. I was investigating myself. But
okay.
First thing when I woke up this morning, I turned it on.
All right. That's cool. I watched it as it happened. And I actually was up fucking around on my phone, so I caught it as it replayed, too. But the whole part where Zach starts acting like he's possessed and he's got that stupid smirk on his face and he's giggling and he's arguing with the big fat girl... I mean,
yep.
isn't there a point to where somebody somewhere goes... This is fucking bullshit. Isn't there a line that we all need to say, okay, Zach's acting? And it's so funny that when he was doing that, that fucking laugh, how he's looking, he looks over to the camera to make sure he's in the shot.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Yep. It takes so much of the legitimacy away of the hard work that people put into this to actually want to make contact. And I, you know, I had it out with Scott Grunewald over the fucking Ghost Adventures bullshit. I like the show. I'm entertained by it. But don't be offended when I say, that's fucking bullshit. You know, the answer isn't, well, there's a turnoff knob. No, yeah, you're right, there is. But there's also a turn-on knob. And it's turning fucking on, and a bunch of people are watching this shit go down. I love the entertainment, and it's the same thing with Steve Huff. Holy fucking Huff, dude! This guy has lost. This guy has lost his mind, dude. He's got Jesus on his side, and he's doing all this shit. And you know what I mean? It was just it did its own thing. But when I did run anything through it, it was so there was so much reverb in it, and you can't adjust the settings without ripping the box apart, even if there is a pedal in there. I don't know. I think he does his own reverb, but it was fucking...
Yeah, but he actually uses a spring reverb, so you can't adjust it even if you wanted to.
It was horrible. It was horrible, dude. I ran my costs through it, I ran my applications through it, and everything was so oversaturated with reverb that I couldn't fucking hear it. So You know, and then you sent me some clips of this box that you've made for your buddy, and I was like, wow, I mean, it sounds so clear just coming through the phone, coming through a Facebook message. I mean, the reverb was nice, it was there, you could hear it, and then on top of that, it wasn't oversaturated. And that's the thing about it, man. I mean, you could pay a lot of money. The gear market is retarded right now, let's face it.
Yep.
You know, the Afterlife box that I actually got from you, very high priced box.
Yep.
You know, not everybody can afford the Poltercom, but the Poltercom, I would have to say this, and I'll put my stamp on it because I love Jeremy and his stuff. The Poltercom is probably the best ghost box that you can get for the money. And if you just get a basic box, you're going to still get a good ghost box. And it's under $1,000. But
yeah, see, there's something I want to say about that, too, is, you know, his Poltercoms, they can get up and get really expensive. But that's all just luxury stuff that you're adding on there.
Right.
If you get just the very basic one that's on there, I mean, it has everything you need to make it work.
Absolutely.
You're still paying less than $500.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. So, I got a couple of upgrades on my box. I got the Periscope built into it and the processor and all that. And it was under $700, around that price, you know, around there. But again, when I turn it on, I don't even have to ask anything. I hope that the audio that I played came through good enough so you could hear it saying Dybbuk and saying my name.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, holy.
Well, that very last one, Dybbuk, came through very, very clear.
Right, dude. Right. And now this is an FM radio sweet box. I can't put that in there. There's no. How many fucking radio shows do you know that says Dimmy box? Dimmy. Who the fuck says Dimmy? I'm gonna tell you right now.
Lord.
I'm gonna tell you,
dude.
Right
I'm
now.
Just gonna be honest. I couldn't understand half the shit that dude was saying.
He was like a boomhauer.
Country.
He was a boom.
Yeah,
hour.
I'm country, and I can't understand.
You know, and I, like I say, dude. I need that the boxes are called Dybbuk boxes. They're not Dimmy boxes, you fucking stupid hillbilly. They're Dybbuk boxes, and they are Dybbuk boxes because the spirits are telling me what they're called. One more. I'll play one more audio file before I get my guest on the line here. We're going to just have a nice pair of rap here in just a few minutes. I got my good buddy Landon Wells coming on. You coming on, Landon? You better be coming on, motherfucker. Okay, but here is... Now, this one is about... I think a minute and about a minute or 2 minutes long. But as I get about a minute into this, this thing really starts firing up on me, and you'll hear it.
I don't know. I just okay. I'm gonna move this off. Is that better? Talk to me and tell me if you like that or not.
My name?
Yeah, that's my name. Do you like this box or do you want it to go?
Now we're coming up on the spot where it gets real interesting. Okay, that was just a bunch of gibber right there. But we're coming up on the spot where the box says my name again. And then it tells me to listen close. And that's pretty awesome. Here you go. It's coming up in just a second. There's Dybbuk.
Can you tell me what this box is called again?
Dybbuk. That's how amazing that is. It says the box. What the fuck? Yes, it says the box, man. After I ask it what to call it. Listen.
When we look over at the gravestone, it would be that name. Like, it was crazy, man.
Right, right. I mean, and that's all you can ask for, basically, in the ITC field, is if you can get any kind of name confirmation, which I usually go after my name. I want to hear my name come through that fucker. After that, I don't care. You know what I mean? Like,
yep.
If it's talking to me, then I'm happy. But, you know, at that point, I mean... You know, like Cheryl Carter out there doing her thing. You know, she's posts a lot of stuff up on her page as well with, you know, videos of interactions and stuff. I mean, so when we do these apps, and you know, because you're in the process of doing it as well, I mean, you have the best intentions for everyone to be able to get some fucking, you know, some contact and some confirmation as you're making it. But when it's done and you start testing it, the first thing you want to do is know that you're connected to the application, you know?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And when you get your name confirmation, I mean, there's just nothing more clear and precise than that. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Like it just, that solidifies everything. And I haven't really ever gotten my name through any type of, you know, spirit box session before until this past couple weeks. I think I was doing a live stream and it said my name twice.
You were on Spiritus. Yeah. You were on Spiritus that night. I was watching the feed. It was incredible, dude. I mean, now and as well, you're also testing your own ghost boxes that you're starting to build. What brought all this on, man? What made you say, I love buying this and I love owning that, but I want to make my stuff?
Yeah, very good question. So going back, I mean, even to our first conversation, the whole reason I started even making any type of gear is to be able to get it out to people at an affordable price. And, you know, just looking at eBay, what, you know, geo boxes are going for, what, you know, portals are going for and stuff. It's just ridiculous, man. I think a geo box went today for like $2,200 or something.
Yeah.
It's just crazy, man. And I just have the philosophy that I want everybody to be able to afford any type of equipment so they can do their own tests. You know what I mean? So
I got you, man.
That's kind of where it all started. Yeah.
I agree fully. The prices are ridiculous. But I do understand. It's a mutual friend of ours both actually owns. Remember on the Paranormal Lockdown season, the little black one that Nick Groff was using on the show? And he was carrying it around. You know, it's a little black handheld geo.
Oh, the geoport?
Yeah, yeah. A mutual friend of ours owns that. Now he paid, you know, he paid into the
$2,800
right,
for it.
Right, right. Almost $3,000 for it. But I can see that because it's a piece of history.
Yep.
You know?
And it's the only one that was ever made like that.
He's making most of that money. I mean,
or
they've paid him such an absurd amount to go hunt that location that they have to charge that to be able to afford having him there in the first place. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
So, you know, and here's the deal, man. You celebrity ghost hunters are so far beyond what we start for, I believe. That if anybody's a celebrity, they don't give a fuck about making contact. They care about making a good show. And the minute the show business takes over, then just consider yourself an entertainer. Don't try to tell the community that you're still a serious ghost hunter. And then, you know, you remember that shit about Aaron coming out and telling him in an interview where he was telling people that the fucking producers from the show put them up to doing stuff. And he was allegedly fired from Ghost Adventures for this interview that he gave. I guess he was fucked up and he just let a little bit too much out in the interview. Which is why
I heard something about it. Yeah.
Which is why I think that you don't ever hear any interviews from these fucking guys doing anything other than on TV.
They don't want to get caught slipping and they don't want to get taken out of the world that they portray themselves to be in. Right. So, I mean, here's another aspect of it. I mean, even going back to Nick Groff, he's doing these investigations where you can go meet him, whatever. Zach Bagans doesn't do that. None of them on Ghost Adventures do that. There's a reason for that, you know? And then, right. I mean,
there has to be a reason for that. There's, you know, well, I mean, he's making a ton of money doing what he's doing. Trust me, I get it. Maybe he doesn't have to do that, and he's got other things going on. But
and like on that,
there's a reason.
Like in the episode that we just watched, where they're at the Vortex, and they're talking about we contacted every witch, you know, community here to talk to us, and nobody would. That's because they think you're full of fucking shit, and they don't want to be portrayed in the wrong way.
Yep, because you don't have any control over that, you know?
Right.
He does. He can chop up that video to whatever he wants you to say.
Well, as a matter of fact, I'm not going to say any names right now, but I'm working on a show right now. A friend of mine, Bonnie, actually hooked me up on this show. And these were some ladies that were actually featured on Ghost Adventures, and they're very unhappy with how they were portrayed. They don't like it. They're going to come on. They're going to tell me the real of what's going on. I'm going to go investigate their place and enjoy some time with them. But exactly. You go on camera and you say what you want to say, and then they take it to the editing room and they fucking dice it and they cut it up. And the end product that they're happy with, you have full sentences and paragraphs. Paranormal disorder. We turned this box on at Leslie's Family Tree our last time there, and it just told Nick exactly what it thought of him. And it picked on him the whole night. Said his name, said he was evil, and then it said a full sentence as he asked it back and said, "What, you think I'm evil?" The box actually said back, "Yeah, I think you're evil." I was like, holy shit, dude. You know, he's even got that on video, you know?
That's what I'm saying. Every bit of this is on video.
Right. Everything's captured. And I'm sitting there just dumbfounded because as far as my apps go, I'm used to one or two words back as far as an answer goes. And you might have to wait a couple of seconds in between, but you get the end point, you know? But this fucking second that we were there, it said the full sentence straight to him in a reply. And it's the longest, clearest sentence I've ever heard in ITC as far as a reply goes. And that's me. I'm sure somebody else has got more out there to talk about. But on that situation, it was insane, dude. Insane.
Yeah, that was a crazy night. And just going over the footage from that night, I was just blown away. Like every 3 seconds, it was just something else, you know?
Right. So, and we were missing it. We were missing it being there, you know? And then you start playing the tapes back and you're like, wait a minute, they were really putting the smack down up on Nick.
Yeah, they were. Nick
took a week off, I think, afterwards. He was so drained because it wasn't just...
He did.
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't even just a verbal. It was they were just attached to him. They had their hooks sunk in him and just made him, you know, not a very happy guy for a week. He was like, I need to take a break. And I totally understood it and respected it, dude, because we witnessed it. They were smacking him around.
Yep. And sometimes you do. You just need to clear your head, you know, and then get back rolling. The thing is, you can't let it keep you down too long. You got to get up and go.
Yeah,
you know?
right. I mean, well, the same thing with the executioner's box. You know, I think that we're on three versions different from the one that I use now. I think it's been edited and changed up a little bit about three or four times since I turned that app on that night. And you know, I've tested every one of the new ones that are out, but I always go back and load my first version in because of what happened to me using that application. And I know that it was in direct result of using that. People can go, you're crazy. That's not what happened. No, but it's what happened. Because my house was straight. You know, well, you've got Demi boxes in your house.
Oh, my God. Not at that time.
You know, you got... You know what I mean? Yep. It takes so much of the legitimacy away of the hard work that people put into this to actually want to make contact. And I you know, I had it out with Scott Grunewald over the fucking Ghost Adventures bullshit. I like the show. I'm entertained by it. But don't be offended when I say that's fucking bullshit. You know, the answer isn't, well, there's a turnoff knob. No, yeah, you're right, there is, but there's also a turn-on knob, and it's turning fucking on, and a bunch of people are watching this shit go down. I love the entertainment spot. And it's the same thing with Steve Huff. Holy fucking Huff, dude. This guy has lost his mind, dude. Now he's got Jesus on his side, and he's doing all this shit. And you see where the entertainment side of it takes. You know, Steve Huff has got God in his corner. He doesn't allow any negative spirits or anything like that. And you got Zach Bagans fucking going out there and being possessed and acting like he's going to fight a big fat girl. And it's just like, where does it stop, dude? That's the entertainment side of it. But in reality, when a person goes on a ghost hunt for real and we're out in this fucking cold place and there's bugs crawling all over us, the air conditioning doesn't work or the heater doesn't work, you're freezing your ass off, you got snot sickles and you need to take a shit, this is not fucking Hollywood, okay? This is not Hollywood. This is the real fucking side of it. And it ain't cool. There ain't no possession going on. It's fucking... You're sitting there and you're waiting for any type of contact.
Yeah, and well, the thing is, you know, when you put yourself on a national recognized, you know, television show like that, you got to be open to criticism either way. So for the dude to trip out when you say something is ridiculous to begin with.
No, he tripped.
And and then, you know, also, like, you know, just being part of the entertainment side, like, you got to think. It's either one side of the spectrum or the other. Anything that's kind of in between there is not as exciting. So that's why Zach is really good at playing the demonic side on everything. And I'm sorry, I can't believe that. I still love the show. Right. I've watched every episode.
I have too.
I'm going to continue to watch the show. There's
absolutely.
Nothing probably going to stop me.
Absolutely.
You know? But at the end of the day, I take that with a grain of salt and I don't apply any of those practices into my investigation style.
Okay, yeah. I'll put it this way. When I was young, I was heavily involved in the martial arts. Very, very involved, okay? Like, everything was Bruce Lee and Chuck Norris, dude, for me as a kid.
Nice.
I practiced and did my shit, okay? The first time I ever got in a fight, I remember it. But you get the end point, you know? But this this fucking second that we were there, it said the full sentence straight to him in a reply. And it's the longest, clearest sentence I've ever heard in ITC as far as a reply goes. And that's me. I'm sure somebody else has got more out there to talk about. But on that situation, it was insane, dude. Insane.
Yeah, that was a crazy night. And just going over the footage from that night, I was just blown away. Like, every 3 seconds, it was just something else, you know?
Right. So, and we were missing it. We were missing it being there, you know? And then you start playing the tapes back, and you're like, wait a minute. They were really putting the smack down up on Nick.
Yeah, they were. Nick
took a week off, I think, afterwards. He was so drained because it wasn't just...
He did.
Yeah. It wasn't even just a verbal. It was they were just attached to him. They had their hooks sunk in him and just made him, you know, not a very happy guy for a week. He was like, I need to take a break. And I totally understood it and respected it, dude, because we witnessed it. They were smacking him around.
Yep. And sometimes you do. You just need to clear your head, you know, and then get back rolling. The thing is, you just gotta, you can't let it keep you down too long. You got to get up and go.
Yeah,
you
know? right. I mean, well, the same thing with the executioner's box. You know, I think that we're on three versions different from the one that I use now. I think it's been edited and changed up a little bit about three or four times since I turned that app on that night. And, you know, I've tested every one of the new ones that are out, but I always go back and load my first version in because of what happened to me using that application. And I know that it was in direct result of using that. People can go, you're crazy. That's not what happened. No, but it's what happened. Because my house was straight. You know, well, you've got Demi boxes in your house.
Oh, my God. Not at that time.
You know, you got Demi boxes in your house. And you know, there's shit going on and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, there is now, but at that time it was pretty quiet here, and it didn't just affect me, it was the whole house. The animals, the children, the wife, everything, everybody was affected at what they fucking heard and saw. So, you know, I go back to that version of it. But when you put these things out there, you know, you're expecting people just to, you know, to use them responsibly and all that stuff. But the crazier the shit you put out there, the crazier people are going to get with it. That's all there is to it.
Yep.
You know? So.
Yep. And with the influence that's out there, that, again, what you see on TV
right.
is already a little bit, right. you know.
End of message.
End of message. You know, I actually have to pause at the stupidity that you all just heard. You all just heard. It's a demon box. It ain't a demon box. Motherfucker sounds like Les Claypool from Primus. Damn, it was a race car driver. You know what I mean? Come on, man. Okay. So, I got that message, and he's going to get my show taken off the air. Lloyd, douchebag, hillbilly. You ain't doing shit, okay? That's why I'm using your name right here, right now. Those are your words. You said this shit. When it comes to Maggie White, we actually were friends at a point, and she did come on the show a couple few times. You know what I mean? But here's the thing. This chick fucking hit me up before all this stuff jumped off with my friend. And she actually told me this. And I'm going to tell you this. This is how disturbing this Facebook Messenger call was that I got from her. She started trying to call up Rod Farrell, and he's one of the makers of one of the Dybbuk boxes that I'm... The Demi box. And he's in prison. He's a very well-known killer who was apprehended for his crimes. And, you know, yeah, the horrible story. But Maggie insisted that I grabbed my pendulum, and she's going to call him forward and say, hey, you know, she's like, Rob, you devil, you need to tell me if these boxes are dangerous and all this shit, right? And I'm just kind of fucking standing there stupefied because he's not dead. He's not dead. He was alive. He does his thing in prison. His name is probably not Rob. It's more like Bob and Neil, because that's what he's doing in prison, because he ain't a big dude. This guy is not a big dude. He's at the leniency of the inmates around him. So she's calling him out, and she's saying, I need this devil fucking, you know, blah, blah, blah. So then she tells me, she goes, because of these boxes are in your house, you have now brought a demon into your home. And I have seen a vision of your child, my small son, being raped. Quote, unquote. The demon wants to rape your child. This is a fucking first version in because of what happened to me using that application. And I know that it was in direct result of using that. People can go, yeah. You're crazy. That's not what happened. No, but it's what happened. Because my house was straight. You know, well, you've got Demi boxes in your house.
Oh, my God. Not at that time.
You know, you got Demi boxes in your house, and, you know, there's shit going on and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, there is now, but at that time it was pretty quiet here, and it didn't just affect me. It was the whole house, the animals, the children, the wife, everything. Everybody was affected at what they fucking heard and saw. So, you know, I go back to that version of it. But when you put these things out there, you know, you're expecting people just to, you know, to use them responsibly and all that stuff. But the crazier the shit you put out there, the crazier people are going to get with it. That's all there is to it.
Yep.
You know? So.
Yep. And with the influence that's out there, that, again, what you see on TV
right.
is already a little bit,
right.
you know,
right.
a little bit over the top, you know?
So. Believe me, man. I'll tell you this as far as one of my ghost stories. I was literally chased down the road by my best friend with a screwdriver in his hand, swinging it at me to plunge this 12-inch long screwdriver through my back. And he was completely overtaken by something that we were messing with these books. They weren't satanic books, but they were, I would say, more of a devil worship side of books. There's a big difference between being a Satanist and being a devil worshiper. Big difference.
But
we fucked around and said some of these spells, and I've seen this guy become completely overtaken by this thing, and it chased me down the road a good 100 yards dash. I mean, and I was young at the time, so I could make that run. Now, you know, if anybody asked me to fucking run, I'd say why, and then if there was somebody chasing me with a screwdriver, I'm just gonna shoot you and it's over with, you know what I mean, the game's over. But as a kid in the, you know, 12-13 year old range, where, you know, I ran, and when we stopped running, we got a distance away from the place we were at, and I stopped after he stopped, and I stopped probably about another 20 or 30 steps after I could see him not chasing me anymore. And I stopped, and I'm just hunched over my knees, and I'm trying to put air in my lungs, and he just was standing there looking at me with this look on his face, and he wasn't out of breath, he wasn't overexerted, he just was there, dude. And, you know, I would actually be attending with the paranormal disorder guys. I'm going to have your camera on display, and we're going to use it and let everybody be able to grab it and run around. I'm actually going to let people use it hands-on so they can get a view of exactly what's going on with it. So if something does get mapped falsely, they can figure out to move it or whatever. But I plan on showing this camera that I stand by 100%. So people can actually get their hands on it and see how it works. So, it's going to be interesting.
That's awesome, man.
Oh yeah, for sure, man. It's going to be an interesting weekend. I know that the show wasn't supposed to happen and it was just kind of a bullshit session, and I know you're pressed for time. So I'm going to let you get up off of here, and, you'll have plenty of video to see people using your cameras. I'm going to film them as they're using it.
Good. Good, man. It's awesome. I just, once you use it, you're going to love it.
Right.
You know? And that's just one piece. I mean, there's tons of other things you can get, but there's just something that's really neat about that, being able to put a figure to the mass of energy that's there. It's crazy to be able to actually visually see it.
I believe that the first time we used your camera there, I believe it was the first time that technology has been in the family tree. So,
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I don't think anybody's taken anyone in there. As far as I remember back, Corey said that she had never seen one in there. So, you know, I think that was the first time. So this weekend coming up again, I'm going to bring it in there. And hopefully downstairs, you know, we didn't ever take it downstairs. So I want to take it down there and see what we can catch in the basement. But Landon Wells of the Paranormal Response Team, man, I appreciate you coming on just for a little bit of shit shooting and some demi box conversations and all that good stuff, man.
So, man, I appreciate it, man. Thank
absolutely.
You. And next time we'll have to do this much longer. We got to beat our 3-hour record.
Right, for sure. I know it's early. It wasn't planned, man. I just was kind of sitting here watching my team lose and was like, I want to play these messages for people and let them hear the audio that I received on my Demi box. And, you know. But anyways, brother, I appreciate your time and for jumping on with me here. And we'll wrap at you soon, brother.
Awesome, Dave. Thanks, man. Have a good night.
You too, buddy.
Bye-bye.
Peace. So just like that. Good dude. I'm looking forward. I'm going to actually travel to his neck of the woods in November. Oh, man, it's going to be crazy. We're going to hunt on a plantation, slave plantation. God almighty, that's just hardcore. But, I came on, I set some shit straight, and I...